you'd have to book him in for an assessment to be assessed by the behaviourist.
One of the demoralising parts of the job is when you sit on reception for an hour or so and every call is somebody wanting to give their dog up, and it's really, really depressing because we just don't have the space to take dogs in, and people are so desperate for whatever reason to give the dog up, and we have to operate a waiting list, you know, to get the dogs in, and people get angry with you because you can't take the dog straight away, and it's just a horrible part of the job, is that.
Welcome to Dogstrust. My name is Donna and I'm going to be doing the grand tour with you today, so I hope you're excited, because I am. Yeah. Now, you've been raising some money for us, haven't you, which is absolutely fantastic, but I wonder if you know exactly what you've been raising money for. What do you already know about Dogstrust? One.
It helps dogs.
We help dogs, absolutely. What kind of dogs?
Any dogs.
Any dogs, we do, but specifically dogs that are looking for a
home.
A home, absolutely right. I visit primary schools mainly. I take my little dog here and we go to schools around the district and we talk to the young children about being responsible dog owners, but also how to stay safe around dogs. We are a rehoming charity. We actually have about 125 dogs on this site today. It's a lot of dogs, isn't it? It shouldn't be seasonal, but it is seasonal. We do tend to rehome more dogs in summer. I suppose it's because people are more inclined to walk them in the summer months, etc. But on average, if you worked out during the year, it'd be about 100 dogs a month that we get in and out.
As well as rehoming lots of dogs, we also take lots of dogs in as well. So people's circumstances change, we are helping them as well and giving their much loved pet a good home. And because there's lots of people bringing the dogs, breaking down in tears, you know. But we reassure them that we're going to give that dog a really good home.
Now, we're a very busy centre. As you can see, we've got loads of people who come and visit, and they're here because they would like to take a dog home. And we have a word with them about what it is to have a dog and all the responsibilities involved. We did the big questionnaire, and that questionnaire is to tell us whether or not we think you're a good dog owner. So you passed the first test because you got a dog, which is brilliant. Now, the second test is finding a dog for you, because they're all different, aren't they? And every person is different as well.
You know, most families are suitable for a dog, it's finding the right dog. So we would only refuse someone a dog if it was real concern.
We've seen another dog, it's similar to him, it's a sort of cross greyhound with something else, the former lurcher. So the name's Ellie, she's a similar age, so we're here to see whether, first of all, they'll go on together and then take things from there.
The first step is the customer usually comes to us and views the dogs that we have here looking for new homes. We ask them to fill out a home finding questionnaire, which is a little bit about them and their circumstances, so we can match them to the right dog. And once they've looked around the centre, they usually have a little list of dogs that they'd like to get to know better, and a member of our rehoming team sits down with them and has a chat about the dogs individually and the dog that will be the most suitable for their family. They then spend time with the dog, take it for a walk on the field, and then if they're happy and they would like to go ahead and rehome the dog, we put what we call a booking on the dog, which is where we reserve it in their name. That's when we arrange to do a home visit, so we go out to their house and make sure it's suitable for that dog, and we also ask them to attend a pre-adoption talk as well.
I think the most rewarding side is seeing a dog that you're quite attached to, and you maybe, because there's this dog that's lived in my office there. There was one called Angel, she was a lurcher, absolutely beautiful, and got really attached to her, and she was just really quirky, and she used to jump on the desks, and she was just so funny. And I got really attached to her, and the most rewarding side was, although it was very upsetting, was seeing her go to a new home, because we had her for quite a while, and it was quite upsetting, because as she drove past looking out the window at me in the car park, I welled up.
There's a lot of people who do think that they want a dog, but actually reality is their lifestyle isn't very suitable because they haven't got enough time, maybe they haven't got enough space, they haven't got a suitable environment.
People don't realise that puppies are very hard work, you know, and they're not cute little things that sit in a basket all day and do nothing, and people just take them because they look cute and don't realise what's involved.
Spend time with your dog, choose your breed carefully as well, don't just go out and buy the first thing that pops into your mind.
If it's a puppy, I think start from scratch, good socialisation, house training, everything.
Insure your dog, make sure you've got veterinary insurance so that if anything does happen to your dog, you know you're covered.
Get a lot of background on the dog if possible. Just so you know what you're taking on.
The level of exercise and the breed traits, and make sure it's the right dog for your family.
Wearing collar tags and microchips, you know, the dog's neutered, everything really.
So these are our new recruits, new arrivals. Now, more importantly, these are stray dogs. What is a stray dog?
Oh, it's where they've been left on their own and they're stuck somewhere.
Absolutely. So they're left on their own, we don't know who they belong to. If you found the dog, how would you know it belonged to? Would you look?
Usually it would have a collar, but if it doesn't have a collar, then you just have to try and catch it.
Yep, or?
A microchip.
A microchip, well done. So all of these guys have been found running around with no collar, no tag, and they've got no chip. So we don't know who they belong to. So all of these were found just wandering and no one's claimed them. Sometimes we get dogs brought in that have been involved in a traffic accident and they come in. Sometimes they've got broken legs, in which do require fixing, or maybe amputating, in which case we get three-legged dogs.
We had a lovely dog brought in a few years ago called Sandy, who was a little lurcher puppy who had multiple cigarette burns on his body, and his leg was broken, and we had to amputate his leg in the end. And I remember he found a really lovely family with a gentleman who was a gardener, so he used to go around helping him. But he was a really special little dog. I loved him.
There was a national news story about two Great Danes, and one of them was blind and the other one was the seeing eye dog for the dog. So the other one was leading the other dog around, actually using the dog's lead.
There's been a lovely greyhound puppy that came in with quite bad head injuries. I thought it was brain damaged, and I fostered him at home for a few weeks. And he came round and he got very attached to me, to the point where wherever I went, he was a foot behind me all the time. A family spotted him and just liked the look of him, and he was rehomed to them, and they do stay in touch with me sort of 3 years down the line. So they're really nice parts. When you foster a little puppy as a baby, and then, you know, they come and see you years down the line and they're grown up into lovely dogs and they're all happy.
Well, 6 months ago we had a dog brought in called Cassie, and she was actually declared the world's fattest dog. Her owner was a lovely old lady, but pretty much tried to kill her with kindness because she was feeding her everything that humans eat. And this dog just ballooned. So she had special rehabilitation, special diet, special hydrotherapy and exercise regimes. And she's dropped half her body weight now and has just gone into a new home.
Always been on the dog side of things. But what happened was I was getting lots of volunteers coming in. And I felt that there was not many people giving them too much time to like appreciate them, really. And I felt it was my job. I had to go and thank them, and I couldn't thank them enough. So I went from the dog side of it to the volunteer coordinating side of it, just so they can be appreciated, and they've got somebody to come to as well if anything should go wrong.
Volunteers are essential, and they're amazing people. They give up whole days of their time, hours, you know, so they're vital to the smooth running of events. But there's also the dog walking side of things. We've got lots of lovely dogs here that all need exercise and TLC. So we have a band of trusty volunteers that come sort of every other day of the week to walk around the fields here and give our dogs exercise.
Part of the reason we don't have a dog now is we had a dog, an old English sheepdog, for 13 years. And when it died, it had a devastating effect on the family. And my wife said, never again. And although that was quite a long time ago, we still haven't managed to get another one. So that fills a bit of a gap for me coming here.
I'm involved with fundraising. I've done some dog grooming. I'm on reception. I try to come on reception at least Saturday or a Sunday afternoon when it is very, very busy. So it's quite varied.
So a big thank you from all the dogs you've seen already and all the future dogs that we're going to get in Dogstrust for doing that wonderful work for us. Hope you understand a little bit more about where it goes now. I definitely love doing the education because it's helping the dogs in a slightly different angle, helping future dogs as well as the ones for today.
It's really lovely, and because I work in reception, I see the dogs arrive when they first come into the centre, but I also see them go home as well. So that makes it a really worthwhile job to see happy families with a new dog.
And it is sad to see initially, but when they're here, you've got to think that actually their lives are on the way up now, and we're going to give them a second chance really and get them back on track and get them new homes. Sometimes it is sad when the dogs leave as well, but they're like, you know, we do shed tears of joy at the same time, because it's really nice to see the end of that dog's journey through Dogstrust into their new environment. So it's got its ups and downs, but it's a very rewarding job in general. It's very rewarding.